بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله ما بعد فإن أحسن الكلام كلام الله وخير الهدى هدى محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم وإن شر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار. This is the second lesson on the subject of the world of magic and jinn, or jinn and magic. And what I'd like to do is, for the people who weren't here for the last lesson, I want to just do a review or a summary of the main points that we covered in the lesson last week. And so this will maybe take maybe 10 minutes of this session, inshallah. And so what we mentioned last week in the first part is we began by giving some background and some context. We said that when you try to understand the topic of magic, it's not something that you really appreciate up until you look at some background information, some background points. So from those points that we mentioned is the story that Allah mentions in the Qur'an about Iblis and Adam, alayhi salam, and how Iblis was created before Adam, and when Allah decided to create Adam, when he willed to create Adam, he ordered Iblis to prostrate along with the angels, and all of the angels prostrated, but Iblis refused, and he refused out of arrogance and pride. And so when he disobeyed, and he knew that Allah had cursed him and that he was doomed, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a respite, for a period of time. And so Allah gave him that respite for a period of time. And then he swore, he promised that he would misguide the whole of mankind. And so anyway, after this period, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he put Adam and his wife in the garden, and he ordered them not to take from the tree, and again as a trial and as a test of their obedience. And then so Shaitan, Iblis, came along, and eventually he managed to deceive them, and eventually they ate from the tree, they disobeyed Allah. And so as a result of this whole thing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he ordered both of them, the jinn and Adam and his wife, to descend and to get down from the paradise. In this regard, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about the fact that there is enmity between Adam and his offspring, or some from amongst them, and between the jinn and his offspring. And so in that regard, we mentioned some of the verses in the Quran when Allah says, قَالَ حْبِتَ مِنْهَا جَمِيعًا بَعْضُكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ أَدُوٌ. Allah says, that get all of you down from here, some of you will be enemies to others. And in another verse in Surah Fatir, in Surah 35, Allah mentions, إِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَكُمْ عَدُوٌ فَاتَّخِذُوهُ عَدُوًا. Indeed, Shaitan is to you an enemy, so take him as an enemy. So basically we have a situation where Iblis is characterized by arrogance and stubbornness, and Adam alayhi salam, being from the ins, from mankind, that he's characterized with forgetfulness. And the word ins, insan, itself comes from the root nasiya, to forget. It's from the nature of man to forget. So he forgot and he disobeyed his Lord. And so this is from the characteristic of mankind as a whole. And so each of them have their offspring. Iblis has his offspring and Adam has his offspring. And so the jinn are made from a certain material, and mankind is made of a certain material. The jinn have certain qualities, mankind have certain qualities. The jinn have a certain type of livelihood, living, food, a type of subsistence, a type of residence, and so on and so forth. And all of that is something which is unknown to us. And likewise, the mankind has their own particular characteristics. So normally, in a normal situation, these two species of beings have really no interaction. The jinn get on with what they do, and mankind do with what they do. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he mentioned in the Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I do not create men and jinn except that they may worship me. So he sent prophets and messengers to both the jinn and the men to invite them to worship Allah alone, to direct all of worship, everything which comes under worship, and to direct it only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the jinn are obligated to obey the prophets and messengers, and so they have to worship Allah, they have to be Muslims, and they have to worship Allah upon Tawheed, and they have to be pious and faithful, and they have to abide by the Sharia, whatever Sharia is applicable to them. And likewise the men, they have to abide by that as well. And so in return for that, they will acquire paradise. So now, when we come to understand magic, or when we come to look at the issue of magic, then magic is something that occurs by the interaction of these two species, between the men and between the jinn. And so the men, they have, for many reasons that we discussed in the previous lesson, and we will mention again in this lesson, that they have certain needs and benefits which they see that they can acquire from the jinn. And the jinn likewise, they see certain benefits and things that they acquire, that they can see and they acquire from the men. Bearing in mind that the jinn or the shayateen are from the offspring of Iblis, and from their goals is to misguide mankind. Right? So they give assistance to mankind. Right? But in return, they ask for some sort of subservience and some sort of worship and some sort of obedience. Such obedience and worship that itself entails disobedience to Allah, and it also enters into the realm of kufr, of disbelief, and likewise shirk, which is polytheism and worshipping other things besides Allah. So anyway, this magic that we mentioned, it has been present at least from the time of Nuh alayhi salam, and we mentioned the proof for that in the Quran. And there were many prophets before the Prophet Ibrahim alayhi salam and before the Prophet Suleiman who were accused of having magic being done upon them. You know, meaning when the people rejected the message, they said that you are just mad and you are possessed and you are this and you are that. And so this shows that magic was present in that time. And so after this we mentioned how, we mentioned a bit about Prophet Suleiman alayhi salam, because this was important to the subject of magic in general. We said that Prophet Suleiman alayhi salam has been wrongly accused of being a magician. And the reason for that was because of the following. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gave to Suleiman a certain kingdom and a certain level of control over, for example, the jinn and over some of the elements like the wind and over like the birds. And such a dominion which he never gave to anybody else after Suleiman, because Allah said in the Quran, mentioning the dua, the supplication of Suleiman alayhi salam, he said, قَالَ رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي, O my Lord, forgive me. وَحَبْ لِي مُلْكًا لَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحَدٍ مِّن بَعْدِي. So he said, O my Lord, forgive me and bestow upon me a kingdom that is not desirable for anybody after me. And we see that the messenger, peace be upon him, also in one of his ahadith, he mentioned words to the meaning that after Suleiman, there is no one who has control over the jinn, not even the Prophet, peace be upon him. And so this was something unique to Suleiman. And so there were, in the Quran we find, Allah mentions that in the Quran that there were some from these Shia, from these jinn, who were forced into obedience to Suleiman alayhi salam. Right? Unwillingly, that they were forced to work for Suleiman. And others from the jinn, they were held captive in chains. In chains. And they had to work for Suleiman in that regard. And so what happened is after Suleiman alayhi salam, he passed away, he died. These devils, what they did is that they began to write books, and they began to write magic, and they began to write things, and then they put them under the throne of Suleiman alayhi salam. And so what happened is, and they began to teach this to the people, right, this magic. And so what happened is when Suleiman died alayhi salam, the Jews, they broke up into two groups of people. The first group were those who, because they were upon Tawheed, they were upon pure monotheism, and they were following the Prophet's teachings. They recognized that this, what is being claimed from these books and what is being written by the devils and what is spreading amongst the people, that this entails kufr and shirk. And so they recognized that and they kept away from it and they warned against it. And another group from the Jews, they believed wrongly that this, when they found these books, they believed that this was how Suleiman was controlling the jinn. Right, that this, the use of this magic and the use of this, these things, this is how Suleiman was controlling the jinn, and it is permissible for us to do the same. And so therefore they fell into this magic. And remember, Suleiman alayhi salam, He was present roughly about 1000 BC, 10 centuries before Isa alayhi salam, roughly around that time. And we also mentioned as well that so the Jews inherited this magic from the devils, and that's why Allah said in the Quran, وَاتَّبَعُوا مَا تَتْلُوا الشَّيَاطِينُ عَلَى مُلْكِ سُلَيْمَانَ, that they, meaning they, the Jews in the time of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they followed what the devils rehearsed in the time of Sulaiman. So meaning that magic which the Jews were practicing in the time of Prophet Muhammad alayhi salam, and which they did upon the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, they inherited that from the devils in the time of the Prophet Sulaiman. And likewise, Allah goes on to mention in the same verse about the two angels, Harut and Marut, in the place called Babel, which is Babylon. We mentioned also that this was another influence where magic came from. And we also mentioned how the Jews, they were held in captivity for a period of time in Babylon around the year 600 BC. And as a result of that, they, because in Babylon, there were the people there were basically astronomers and they were star worshippers. And so they also had their form of magic and numerology and astrology, and all, they had all these symbols and representations of, in numbers. And by way of that, they used to worship the stars and believe that the stars used to have spirits within them. And so they used to have their type of magic. And this magic, the Jews, the rabbis, they acquired that magic when they were in Babylon. And then when they came and they came back to Jerusalem and they began to write the Talmud. The Talmud is not the same as the Torah. The Torah is what Musa al-Islam brought. And the Talmud is something which the rabbis wrote with their own hands. And they brought within it all of their own opinions and a lot of the superstition and astrology and numerology and so on and so forth. And so this magic was something that they were upon. And so we mentioned in the previous lesson as well how you see when you look at many of these spells and talismans and things that are written by so-called Muslims, you find parallels between them and between what you find amongst the Jews who follow the Talmud, and the spells that they write, and the incantations, and the symbols, and so on and so forth, that all of this is, you know, the root of it, and the source of it is very, very clear and very apparent. So anyway, from this, we understand that magic is an interaction between the jinn and between the men. And practically speaking, we mentioned how it works. And so what happens is that we have two elements to magic. The first is what we call the base and the foundation. This usually takes the form of an artifact, which is like a spell, it can take many different forms. In fact, we will mention them in a short while. It can take maybe 9 different forms. But basically, this thing is prepared, which we call the base and foundation. It will be something written. It may be something which has knots in it. It can be something that is prepared in food, something which is buried, something which is put in water. And it can, you know, take on different forms. But that's the starting point. And so what then happens is that the magician, and a magician is someone who has won the assistance of the devils because he has done something. He has done something. He has to commit something and do something by which the devils are prepared to work for him and to execute the magic for him. So basically he takes this thing. This thing is, someone takes it, they plant it somewhere, and the jinn then goes, the magician then goes, and he calls upon the jinn and he announces the like a contract. So he says, "Oh, so-and-so," he mentions the names of the jinn, and he says that entrusted upon you is this talisman. And the talisman is that part of the spell in which there are numbers and symbols and things of that nature, you know, by which the jinn are invoked. So he says, "I entrust you with this talisman that you implement this magic upon so-and-so, the son of so-and-so, or so-and-so, the daughter of so-and-so, and that you do such and such," whatever. So then this, what happens is that in the jinn side of things, as we said, that amongst the jinn, just like amongst the men, there are the common people, then there are the powerful people, then there are the kings amongst them, then and so on and so forth. And likewise amongst the jinn, you have the same thing. And so when the magic is done, the people who, the magicians, they are basically invoking and honoring and calling upon the high-level jinns. And so once the high-level jinns see that they have some sort of obedience from the men, and to them it's like they see it as a kind of honorable thing amongst themselves. They see that they are worshipped by the men, that they are obeyed by the men, that they are held in esteem by the men. This is how they see amongst the jinn. So the high level jinn then sends a low level jinn. He says, "Right, you go." And so the low level jinn is sent, and then whatever type of magic it is, then that low level jinn is entrusted to fulfill that particular type of magic. So then this jinn comes along, and so depending on what type of magic it is, there are 8-9 types of magic, that jinn will then remain with that person, or will enter that person, and then, you know, depending on what type of magic it is, it will remain there and produce that effect, as long as that spell or that magic remains. And so this is how practically it's working, and we see that this is a type of, as we said, it's a contract and an interaction between jinn and men, upon that which is haram, upon that which is batil, upon that which involves disbelief and shirk, upon that which involves oppression against the people, and oppression against them, their wealth, their health, and so on and so forth. And so this is why the ruling upon magic in the Quran, we mentioned that last week as well, that the ruling upon magic is that it is kufr, it is disbelief. Anyone who is known to be a magician, and we mean by magician not the one who, as we said, does tricks with the eyes and so on and so forth, you know, makes things disappear, and, you know, we talk like which are tricks, you know, which are played. We mean the one who uses the assistance of the jinn. This person is a disbeliever. And that's why when the companions of Allah's Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, that whenever they used to conquer a land or go into a land, and it was known to them that there are magicians, then they would execute them. They would be executed. And that's the ruling upon a magician in Islam, that he is executed. He doesn't even have repentance. We don't even let you repent if you are established to be a magician. Because of the evil and the corruption that these people, you know, bring upon mankind. So anyway, after that, we then mentioned the types of magic. And so from them, we mentioned there were 9 types of magic. We mentioned them in some detail. I'll just quickly mention them very quickly again. We mentioned that the first type is the sihr of tafriq, which is the sihr of separation between two people. Mainly it's a man and his wife, but it can be between, you know, a man and his son, a man and his brother, a man and his mother. It can be between anybody, even between a man and his neighbor, a man and his business partner. It can be between anybody. So basically a jinn comes, and so he's entrusted with creating hardship and difficulty between the two people, misunderstandings and so on and so forth, up until they split. And there are certain effects that come along with that, certain signs, certain manifestations. That's the first type. Second type is what we call the sihr of al-mahabba, of love. Another word for it is at-tiwala. And this is when the magic is to bring two people together, mainly for the purpose of marriage. Right, to bring about love between them, and to make them obsessed with each other, and to make them infatuated with each other, and so on and so forth. That's the second type. Third type is the sihr of takhyil, which is the imagination, where you start imagining things, that you saw something that you didn't see, that is not there, or that you heard something that is actually not there. So you start seeing things and imagining things and perceiving things which are just all in your faculties and in your mind. They don't have any external reality. The fourth type of magic is the sihr of al-junoon, which is basically just madness, and where you lose control over your speech and you stumble and you know, basically you don't really have control over your senses and even over your body. And in all these different types of magic, the jinn is playing about. He either enters into your body and then plays about with that part of the brain which is responsible for control over certain, you know, faculties, like maybe thinking, or maybe having the zeal and motivation, or maybe over happiness and joy and sadness and whatever. And so it plays about with those kind of aspects, and as a result, certain effects are found upon a person. This is the fourth. The fifth one is the sihr of al-khumul, which means lethargy, where a person can't be bothered doing anything, just wants to laze around, sit around. He's got no motivation, no dedication, no, you know, intent, no zeal, and nothing. He just finds that he can't do anything. He doesn't want to work, can't be bothered to work, doesn't want to speak to anybody, just wants to be by himself. And again, this is a type of magic. The next one is sihr al-hawatif, which is the magic which is a person just getting voices and imaginations in the mind and whisperings. And so these things start coming into his mind, thoughts and ideas and whispers, and he starts getting confused and this and whatever. And that's another type. The seventh one is the magic of al-marad, or disease. And this is when, for example, someone has a pain or a numbness in an arm or in a leg, or a pain somewhere or in the head, and it doesn't go. No matter what a person does, no matter what treatment a person receives, the pain always remains. So basically, The way to tell between whether this is a genuine illness, like a genuine pain, physical pain in the arm, or whether it is a result of magic, is that normally that we read ruqya upon a person, we read the Qur'an, and then certain effects are seen, as a result of which it is known that this is magic and not a genuine illness. Right? So illness sometimes, it might appear to be illness, but it is actually the effect of magic. That's the seventh type. The eighth type is unique to women. We said it is al-istihada, which is when a woman has a constant bleeding and she thinks it to be menstrual blood, but it's not menstrual blood. Rather, it is a vein, and that particular vein and it bleeding constantly is actually as a result of a jinn, which is a result of magic, right? So he enters into the body, he enters into that particular location, and so that vein continues to bleed, and it doesn't end, sometimes for weeks, sometimes for months. And so many women have this particular problem, and it is a sign that this is from the jinn and from the effects of magic. And the last one, sihr ta'til al-zawaj, which is where magic is done in order to prevent two people from getting married, right? And so all of these types of magic, you see that they emanate from people who maybe have a jealousy or a hatred or a dislike for somebody else, and so they seek to harm them, and so they go to a magician, and you know they pay the magician a miserable price. And for that miserable price, the magician is someone who, you know, works with the devils to bring about this type of harm and oppression upon the people. And so these were the types of magic, as we said. We also spoke about what does a magician have to do in order to win the assistance of the devils. We mentioned many things. We mentioned, in fact, that the jinns never ever aid anybody from the men unless they see some kind of obedience from the men. And the jinn are not pleased except in misguiding mankind and to make them disobey Allah and to worship other things besides Allah and to give servitude to other things besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so we mentioned many things, the jinn, the some of the magicians which we find amongst them. They, for example, and it varies from extremes, you know, from one extreme to the other side. So from the extreme side of it, we see that some of these magicians, they have to disbelieve in Allah, they have to disrespect the Quran, they have to revile the prophets and messengers, they sometimes throw the Quran in the toilet, sometimes they walk on the Quran, sometimes they do all these filthy, vile things. And that's like one extreme. And there are magicians who actually do that. And as I said, that we shouldn't be deceived by people who appear to be religious and appear to be practicing and appear to be all pious and so on and so forth, because this is found amongst the people. In fact, I showed you some pictures last, in the last lesson, this particular picture here, where you see the Quran, and on it you see menstrual blood. This top one here is blood from menstruation, from a woman's period, and it's besmirched on the Quran. And the ones below it, you see that this is the Quran rolled into a tampon, and a woman inserts it, and so that menstrual blood comes onto the Quran, right? And I showed you some of these pictures from the last lesson. And so the point being that there are people who appear to be religious and they are prepared to do these kind of things in order to win the assistance of the jinn and the devils and in order to effect the magic that they seek. So anyway, that's from one extreme. But maybe some of the magicians don't go to that level because they maybe know that this is outright rebellion against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So other magicians, the way the jinns trick them is that they make them do certain actions which involve worship of other things besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they might say to the magician that, okay, you know, we'll help you, just go and take a few lambs or some chickens, go to a certain place when, you know, at a certain time, just sacrifice them. And once you've sacrificed them, then go to another place, some deserted building or some other place, and just leave them there, or sprinkle the blood, you know, somewhere, and just leave them there. And once you do that, then, you know, we will help you in whatever it is. So now what's happened is that they've made the magician fall into an act of shirk. Because to sacrifice to other than Allah, to sacrifice to a jinn or for a jinn, is an act of worship, which expels a person from the fold of Islam. It invalidates a person's tawheed, monotheism. And so some magicians who are involved with the jinn, they won't go to the level of where they will disrespect the Quran and, you know, abuse and revile the prophets and messengers, because they know that this is something that they will fall into. But the jinn will make them fall into other things. So the point being that the magicians who work with the devils, then the devils make them do a range of things if they can, from the most evil and rebellious and despicable of things. If not, then they move backward, something less, something less, something less, something less, something less. Right? So no matter which magician it is, he is doing at least something, or he is doing at least something in order to win the assistance of the devils, without any doubt at all. And then we mentioned some of the signs of a magician. What, you know, how can you tell someone is a magician? We mentioned many things in that regard. You know, magicians, they will give you, they will, if you go to them, they will tell you your name, your mother's name, where you came from, why. You know, somehow they have this information from nowhere. They will often ask you for a piece of clothing that you've been wearing. They will give you papers with numbers upon them and symbols and squares and things like this, which are a representation of magic and the use of the devils. They will give you things like the skins of animals and things they've written in triangles. And, you know, we mentioned all of them in the last lesson as well, how you can tell that someone is involved in magic, even if at the same time he appears to be using the Qur'an and appears to be using the sunnah of the Messenger alayhi salam. So there are certain signs you can tell that this is from a magician. And in this regard, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there's a verse in the Qur'an in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions this mutual benefit between the jinn and the men. Allah says in the Qur'an, this is in Surah Al-An'am, Surah 6, verse 128. Allah says, وَيَوْمَ يَحْشُرُهُمْ جَمِيعًا, the day that Allah gathers them all together, meaning the jinn and men. Allah will gather them all together, meaning the day of resurrection. So on that day, Allah will say, يَا مَعْشَرَ الْجِنِّ قَدِ اسْتَكْثَرْتُمْ مِنَ الْإِنسِ. Allah will say, O gathering of the jinn, you have indeed sought benefit from the men. And then the jinn will say, Allah says, وَقَالَ أَوْلِيَاؤُهُمْ مِنَ الْإِنسِ. Then their awliya, meaning their allies from the men, meaning the allies of the jinn from the men who used to be allies to the jinn, that they will say, now the men will say, that رَبَّنَا اسْتَمْتَعَ بَعْدُنَا بِبَعْدٍ, that, O our Lord, some of us, we sought benefit, we sought mutual benefit and pleasure, some of us from others, meaning between the jinn and men. And then they will say, وَبَلَغْنَا أَجَلَنَا الَّذِي أَجَلْتَ لَنَا, and we have now reached the appointed time which you appointed for us, meaning death and resurrection, and now we're having to answer for their deeds. So now we've reached that appointed time. Then Allah will say to them, قَالَ النَّارُ مَثْوَاكُمْ, that the fire is your abode, to both of you, to the jinn and the men amongst you. خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا إِلَّا مَا شَاءَ اللَّهُ, that you will abide therein except as Allah wills. So upon this verse, the scholars have mentioned that this verse is an indication that from the jinn and from the men were those who sought mutual benefit in each other in the manner described. And so their eventual destination will be that their abode is in the hellfire. And so just to conclude, I think we mentioned last lesson as well that there are maybe 8 or 9 different ways that the magic is done. The first of them is that it is put into food, right? It is put into food. Second of them is that it is put into drink, in water. The third of them, that it is put into something which is smelt in a scent, or the bukhur, the smoke, which is, you know, when you burn something and the smoke from it. The fourth of them is that knots are tied. You see cotton being used or wool being used, and knots are tied, and sometimes a person's hair is used and it's tied into it. The fifth of them is that there are some pieces or remnants from a person's clothing or from the hair or from whatever. Or sometimes even they find a photo and they cut out just the face region, just that, and they place that within the spell. So this is another way that it is affected. The sixth way is that sometimes they take something and they crush it. It is crushed and a spell is put on it, and then they sprinkle it in the house or whatever. The seventh one is that with respect to something that flows like water or blood or whatever else, then they make a concoction out of it and then they sprinkle it on the walls or upon someone's clothes, or it could be like a dye or something, and they put it on the clothes and or they put it in, you know, certain places. That's the seventh one. And the eighth one is that you write talismans, and talismans are basically, you know, the talasim, which are the numbers and the symbols and the squares and so on and so forth. And all of this involves numerology and astrology and the worship of the stars and the worship of the spirits, and that's where it originates from. And so some of it is affected in that manner. And I showed you last week pictures of where these magicians, they disguise talismans and make them appear to be Islamic. So you'll find many Quranic verses written, and there'll be the names of the companions, the names of Allah, names of the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam. And then in the midst of all that, you will see like numbers and letters written backwards in Arabic, and names that you can't recognize, and squares like the magic square, the 3x3 magic square, which represents Saturn, or the 4x4 magic square, which represents Jupiter. I mean, this is like a star worship. And they will have 5 pointed stars and all these different symbols. And I showed you examples of that last week. In the lesson. And so what they do is they try to disguise this use of magic, but try to disguise it in the form of something that appears to be Islamic, and the use of the Quran. And the ninth one is that the ninth way that they do it is basically what they do is they watch out for the moon and the stars, that there's a specific time that they have to make a certain incantation or, you know, do whatever it is. And so they watch for the rising of certain stars, of certain constellations, or the moon. And then that's the right time in which the magic is affected. So anyway, this was just a recap as a reminder of what we did in the last lesson. It's important to keep that in mind. And today what we're going to do, inshallah, is again, we have a lot of material. So maybe, you know, we're going to try to get as much of this as finished as possible. And so what we need to do is... basically, there are 4 different things that we have to distinguish between. A lot of people, they sometimes mix and confuse between a number of different things. These 4 things are the following. Magic, as-sihr, which is what we've been discussing. And we discussed that in the last lesson. We'll continue discussing it today, inshallah ta'ala. That's the first thing. The second thing is as-sara. As-sara, it involves the jinn, but it is not the same as magic. As-sara is basically possession, right? Because when a jinn possesses a person, it can happen in different for different reasons and from different methods. First method can be through the route of magic, sihr. The other method can be through just purely, as we will look when we look at as-sara in detail, it can be from the angle of just oppression, like a jinn just willfully wanting to oppress a person. Without any magic or anything like that at all. So as-sara is something different to as-sihr, which is magic. And inshallah, we will look at that in a short while. And the third thing is al-hasad. Al-hasad is jealousy and envy. Jealousy and envy. That's the third thing. And the fourth thing is al-ayn. Al-ayn is the evil eye. And the evil eye is connected to al-hasad, jealousy. Right, they overlap with each other, right? So, al-hasad and al-ayn are not the same as magic, but because they are all connected, because all of these topics are really interconnected, and you see that, you know, often jealousy amongst the people, right? Jealousy amongst the people is what leads people to either give you the evil eye or to want to do magic upon you. Right? They're all connected issues. For that reason, I think it's important that we discuss each of these issues, understand the differences between them, and try to learn how to avoid falling into, you know, the as-sara and the evil eye and so on and so forth. So the first thing we're going to look at is, the issue of the evil eye. And so the evil eye, first of all, we'll look at not evil eye, we'll look at jealousy. Jealousy first and foremost. So jealousy, firstly, what is jealousy? There's a type of jealousy which is halal, which is permissible. Yajuz, it is permissible, it's recommended. And there is a type of jealousy which is haram. So we are speaking here of the jealousy which is haram. And the other types we will look at in a short while, inshallah ta'ala. So this jealousy, what is the definition of jealousy? Jealousy is defined as that you wish that a favor or a blessing which somebody else has been given. Now someone else has been given a favor or a blessing. It could be money, it could be wealth, it could be knowledge, could be understanding, could be iman, could be taqwa, could be, you know, offspring, could be beauty, could be whatever. That someone has a favor or a blessing that they have, and you wish for that favor to end, to finish. that that person no longer has it anymore. You want it to end in him. You want him to lose it. And so this is the definition of jealousy. Now, what happens is that the foundation of it is of jealousy is that the eye of a person, he sees something which amazes him, right? So he sees someone, maybe he has beauty or handsomeness or richness or wealth, or he has the religion, he's pious, he's righteous, or whatever the things it might be that a person might be jealous of. And so he sees it with his eye, and then there is some filth in his heart. And that filth in his heart is, things like the diseases of jealousy and covetousness and all those kind of things. And then these two combine. And then when he looks at the individual, that look is something that brings about harm by Allah's permission. By Allah's decree, if Allah decrees, then it will bring about harm in the one who is, who is envied. And this is the definition of al-hasad, jealousy. And we see in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions al-hasad in a number of places. And this hasad can come from a number of different roots and angles. From them is the first one, Allah mentions about the kuffar, but the non-Muslims. Allah says, وَإِن يَكَادُ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لَيُزْلِقُونَكَ بِأَبْصَارِهِمْ لَمَّا سَمِعُوا الذِّكْرَ وَيَقُولُونَ إِنَّهُ لَمَجْنُونَ إِنَّهُ لَمَجْنُونَ. So Allah says that those who disbelieve, it is that they wish to smite you with their eyes. They want to smite you with their eyes. Because when they hear the remembrance, when they hear the Quran, the remembrance, they say, indeed he is possessed. What this is referring to is that those kuffar in the time of the Prophet Muhammad peace be upon him, they were jealous of him. They were jealous of him, and they were jealous of the revelation. And when they would look with jealousy upon the Prophet peace be upon him and upon the believers. And so this jealousy is something from which the eyes, that the evil eye can come from. Another proof is in the Quran again regarding the people of the book, the Jews and the Christians. Allah says, وَدَّ كَثِيرٌ مِّنْ أَحْلِ الْكِتَابِ لَوْ يَرُدُّونَكُمْ مِّنْ بَعْدِ إِيمَانِكُمْ كُفَّارًا حَسَدًا مِّنْ عِنْدِ أَنفُسِهِمْ. That many of the people of the book, they wish that if they could turn you away from your deen, from your religion, from your faith, into disbelievers, out of envy from their own souls. So you see that the Jews and the Christians, that even they have an envy. They see that the Muslimin, the believers, that they have the Quran, they have the pure revelation, they are upon Tawheed, they are upon Iman, and they have this clear, pure Iman and monotheism that they don't have, and they have envious jealousy. And when they look with envious jealousy, as if they want to turn you away from that Iman into disbelief. So this is the second angle from which this jealousy comes, and it can be in the form of an evil eye upon a Muslim and upon a believer. The third one Allah mentions in general. Allah says, أَمْ يَحْسُدُونَ النَّاسَ عَلَى مَا آتَهُمُ اللَّهِ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ. So Allah is mentioning about a group of people that are they envious and jealous of the people on account of what Allah has given them from his own bounty. Right? So in other words, it shows that people can be jealous of others on account of what Allah has given to others of the favors and the blessings which a person does not have. And the fourth one, in Surah Al-Falaq, Allah says, وَمِن شَرِّ حَاسِدٍ إِذَا حَسَدٍ. That I seek refuge from the evil of the one who is envious and jealous when he envies. All of this is a proof to show Al-Hasad and its connection to the evil eye is true and real. And likewise, in the Sunnah, the Messenger said, alayhi salatu wasalam, Al-Aynu tadkhul ar-rajula al-qabr. That the evil eye enters a man into the grave. Meaning the evil eye can actually kill a person. Just like it can make a person ill. It can also kill a person. And likewise, the Messenger said in a hadith, which is reported by Bukhari, in his tarikh, أَكْثَرُ مَنْ يَمُوتْ مِنْ أُمَّتِي بَعْدَ قَدَاءِ اللَّهِ وَقَدْرِهِ بِالْعَيْنِ. That the majority of those people who die in my ummah after Allah's qada wal qadr is by the evil eye. This shows to you that the effect of the evil eye is more than what people think. In this hadith, the Messenger is saying that after Allah's qada wal qadr, most of those who die from this ummah, they die on account of the evil eye. On account of the evil eye. And there are other hadith which are similar to this. And so this is a proof for al-hasad and the evil eye in the Qur'an. As for the types of al-hasad, the types of envy, now this is where we need to make a distinction. As we said, there are three types. There are three types of envy. The first one is, so pay attention to the distinction between each of these three. The first one is that a person wishes that some wealth or some knowledge or some honor or position or authority or anything that a favor that someone possesses or a bounty that someone has, he wants it to end. He wants it to finish. And he himself wants to have it for himself. Right, do you understand? There's two elements to it now. This is the first type. There are two elements. That you want this favor and this bounty and this blessing that somebody else has, you want it to end. Firstly, that you don't want him to have it. And secondly, you want to have it. Right? There are two elements. This is the first type of jealousy. The second type, and this type is haram. The second type of jealousy is that a person sees a favor or a bounty in somebody else and he wants it to end, but he himself does not really want it. Right? He just wants it to end in that other person. Right? He doesn't necessarily want it for himself. This one is more evil than the first one. This one is more evil than the first one. This is more evil. This is more lowly and more despicable than the first one. And this one is haram as well. Right? And the third one is that a person wants to have a bounty or a blessing that is with somebody else, but he doesn't want it to stop in that other person. Right? So if someone else has got maybe some knowledge or some wealth by which he's giving sadaqah and charity, then a person wants that for himself, but at the same time, he doesn't want that person not to have it. He still wants that person to have it. Right? So this type of jealousy is something that is permissible in the Sharia. It is permissible for you to be jealous of somebody else, but as long as it is in the religious affairs. Right? This is a healthy type of jealousy. And in this regard, we see the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said that there is no jealousy except in the case of two men. I do not show jealousy except in the case of two men. A man to whom Allah has given wealth, so he never ceases to use that wealth in the path of the truth. And a man to whom Allah has given hikmah, wisdom, and so he never ceases to use and to judge by this truth, by this wisdom. And he teaches it to the people. These are the only two cases in which you are can show jealousy, the permitted form of jealousy. As for the other two, then they are, as we said, that they are haram. And also, we should also understand that there is a type of evil eye that also comes from the jinn. The jinn can also give you an evil eye. It's something that sometimes we neglect. So the jinn, and the proof for this in the Quran, there's actually proof that the jinn can give you an evil eye as well. Doesn't just only come from another person, it comes from a jinn as well. And so Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Al-A'raf, Surah 7, verse 27, Allah says about Iblis, He says, إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ هُوَ وَقَبِيلُهُ. That indeed he, meaning Iblis, he sees you and his tribe, meaning the devils and the jinn with him. They see you min haythu la tarawnahum. They see you from where you do not see them. Inna ja'alna shayateen awliya'a lilladheena la yu'minoon. That indeed we have made the shayateen, the devils, to be allies and protectors and friends of those who do not have any faith. And also a proof for this as well is the hadith reported by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu. He said that the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before the last two chapters of the Qur'an, the Mu'awwadhatayn, before they were revealed, before they were sent down, that the Messenger used to seek refuge from the eye of the jinn, the evil eye of the jinn, the aynul jinn, and from the aynul ins, min a'yunil ins. That he used to seek refuge from these two things. And then, when the last two chapters of the Qur'an were revealed, he left everything else, and he just used these two chapters to protect himself from everything. And he left everything else. This hadith is a proof. This hadith is in Ibn Majah, it is Sahih. This hadith is a proof that the Messenger, alayhi salam, used to seek refuge from the evil eye of the jinn. So you see that a Muslim, a believer, look at from all these different angles. He has first of all the kuffar, right? They, how they look at the believers with envious jealousy. right? Because of their faith and their iman and their tawheed. And likewise the Ahlul Kitab. And likewise you have the believer. He may be has people looking at him with the eye of jealousy because he has wealth. And likewise he has other people looking at him. The jinn looking at him as well. Because of envious jealousy. So it shows that a man, a believer, is in extreme danger from all these different roots. You know, from the angle of jealousy and the evil eye. And so he needs to protect himself. Also worthy of mention here, since we are on this topic, is that the evil eye itself is from Al-Qadr. It is from Al-Qadr. It is something that Allah has decreed. And the evil eye is just simply one of the ways and means by which certain effects are brought about. So illness is brought about through the means of the evil eye. Just like illness is brought about when, you know, maybe you eat something harmful, something toxic, something damaging, and you fall ill, then and that is a ways and means. Likewise, the evil eye is a ways and means. Likewise, it could be that a person dies from cancer, maybe he dies by, you know, having a crash or an accident or whatever. Then likewise, the evil eye is from the ways and means through which Allah has decreed that certain things take place. So the evil eye, al-ayn, is itself from Al-Qadr. And in fact, the messenger mentioned in a hadith, he said something very important about the evil eye. He said, Al-aynu haqq, that the evil eye is true. وَلَوْ كَانَ شَيْءٌ سَابِقُ الْقَدْرِ سَبَقَتْهُ الْعَيْنِ, that the evil eye is true and real. And if there was anything that would precede Qadr, it would be the evil eye. What this means is that if there was anything that would make something happen before it had been decreed, if there was anything, then it would be the evil eye. Why? Because the evil eye is such that it very rapidly and powerfully brings about whatever effect it is. That meaning this shows the effect of the evil eye. So it is so effective that if there was anything that would actually make something to occur before Allah had decreed it to occur, it would be the evil eye. So this is how the messenger has described the evil eye. So anyway, this is the evil eye, and there are some differences between the evil eye and jealousy. Because remember, we said that jealousy and evil eye are connected, and there's an overlap between the two, right? So, but it's not the case that everyone who is jealous necessarily has the evil eye, because al-ayn, basically, the evil eye occurs in two ways. And this is where we know the distinction between what is al-ayn and what is al-hasad, jealousy. The evil eye can be, for example, when you see something with the eye which amazes you and which you think to be amazing. It could be anything. It could be the beauty of someone. It could be the wealth of someone. It could be the car of somebody. It could be the house of somebody. It could be the child of somebody. It could be anything, that you know, the phone, anything. And you look at it and it amazes you. And you say, wow, that's amazing. Right? So that amazement, you speak in amazement, and you do not say MashaAllah, and you do not say Tabarakallah, and you do not, you know, bring and make supplication for blessings, right? You do not do any of that. So that when that occurs, then this is how the evil eye befalls. This is how the evil eye befalls, and this can happen from anybody, even a righteous person, even a pious person. It can happen from anybody, someone who has iman and faith. This type, the al-ayn, can happen from anybody. Right? So as a result, some affliction comes upon that thing or that person or whatever else it is. That's one, that's the al-ayn. And al-hasad, which is the jealousy, is when someone sees something which amazes him with the eye, then he has in his heart and his soul the filth and those evil, lowly, despicable feelings of jealousy. And want, you know, and wanting something to end in somebody that that he's jealous of, and then that filthy, that internal, whatever it is, it mixes and it comes out, and it comes through the eye, and it looks with the eye upon that thing or that person, and then this is another way that the evil eye now is executed, right? So, but this is al-hasad. This is jealousy coming through the, you know, and affecting it through the evil eye, and the evil eye is the other one, as we said, when you are amazed and you don't say MashaAllah, you don't ask for Allah's blessings upon that thing, then this is the other way. So basically, al-ayn and al-hasad have a connection to each other. They overlap to a certain degree, but there's a slight difference between the two. So anyway, this is al-ayn and al-hasad, and now we move on to as-sara. And as-sara, as we said, is something which involves jinn, but it is not necessarily magic, not necessarily sihr. So what is as-sara? The word as-sara, it literally means to be paralyzed or to be taken and thrown on the ground. This is what the word as-sara means. And what it means is, what it refers to is, it is something by which a person's limbs, like his major limbs, like his arms and his legs, and the things that he can actually, you know, move, that these limbs are prevented from being able to function properly. Right? Basically, it's a type of paralysis and a type of, paralysis. And there are two causes for this. There are two causes. One which is what we can, say is like a natural physical cause, where as a result of maybe some toxins or whatever, some other something that he's breathed which is harmful, which goes to his brain, or maybe there are other reasons that lead him to have this paralysis or like epilepsy basically. This is one type, and this is, as we said, it is something whose cause is of this type. And the second type, it can be from the jinn. The second type is that it has its origin in the jinn. And this can be for a number of different reasons, which we'll inshallah come to explain in a short while. But basically, this type of paralysis where you have a numbness in the arm or numbness in the leg, or maybe you have a fit, or maybe you have, whatever else, then all of this, it can be from the jinn. And why they do it, we will come to look at in a very short while, inshallah ta'ala. But firstly, what is the proof that this type of possession by the jinn, which doesn't involve magic, that this exists? The proof for that is we'll look at a number of proofs. First of all, from the Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions about those who are involved in usury or in interest, dealing with interest. Allah says, الَّذِينَ يَأْكُلُونَ الرِّبَى لَا يَقُومُونَ إِلَّا كَمَا يَقُومُ الَّذِي يَتَخَبَّطَهُ الشَّيْطَانُ مِنَ الْمَسِ. That those who eat and devour riba, usury, interest, they will not stand, meaning on the day of judgment, except as the one who stands, who has been touched by the shaitan, the mas, by the shaitan, just like he stumbles. And so this is, the scholars have used this verse as a proof to show that this is an evidence for as-sara, meaning this possession by the jinn and this touching by the devil, which affects a person and which harms him in his body, in his limbs, that this is true and this is real. And basically it means that these people will stand on the day of judgment just like a person who is touched and by the jinn. A second proof is the well-known hadith about the woman in the time of the Prophet, peace be upon him, alayhi salatu wasalam. There was a black woman who used to suffer from this sara, this possession. And so what the messenger, she came to the messenger and the messenger said, if you want, I will ask Allah to cure you. And if you want, I will ask, you can have patience and then you will be granted paradise. Right? So the woman said, rather I will have patience and I will seek paradise. But however, whenever I am possessed or whenever this comes and afflicts me and I fall on the floor, then my body becomes uncovered. So pray to Allah that I do not become uncovered when I'm afflicted with this. So the messenger, he then supplicated to her for that, but she chose to have patience and to enter paradise rather than to be cured from this affliction. So that is a proof to show that there is, that the jinn can enter a person. The third proof is that the messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, said in a hadith reported by Bukhari, inna shaytana yajri min ibn adam majra dam. That indeed, the shaytan, he flows in the son of Adam, just like the blood flows in him. Meaning that the jinn can enter a person and they flow within the body, just like a person's blood flows within his body. All of this is a proof for as-sara. And basically, as we said, the reason why it can occur from a jinn is the following. There are three reasons. The first one is that a jinn has an infatuation. Or an obsession. So a male jinn has an obsession with a female human being, a human. Or a female jinn has an obsession and infatuation, meaning that it loves and has ishq towards a man. And so therefore he enters into that person. And there are certain ways and conditions by which this jinn seeks. There are certain conditions a person can be in that a jinn seeks in order to enter into that person. Anyway, this is the first reason. Second reason is that a person, he's done dhulm upon a jinn. So maybe he threw out some boiling water in some place, and maybe there was a jinn in his household, and so he killed some of those jinn, or he destroyed their home. So out of revenge, the jinn decides now to enter into a person and to harm him. And so this is what we call asara. And the third reason is that for absolutely no reason at all, there isn't any reason, a jinn just comes along and decides to harm somebody. However, this can only really occur when he finds in that individual certain emotional states and certain emotional conditions. And those conditions are four in number. First of all, when he's extremely angry. When a person is extremely angry, his body is such that it becomes easy for the jinn to enter. Second condition is extreme fear. When a person is extremely fearful, again, the body is in such a condition that it becomes easy for the jinn to penetrate the body. The third condition is when a person is involved in fulfilling his lusts and desires, meaning extreme pleasure. Right? He's involved, you know, he's engrossed in the shahawat, in those things that bring about pleasure and so on and so forth. Right? So in that condition, the jinn finds it easy to enter. And the fourth one is when a person is just heedless of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, far away from Allah's remembrance, far away from Allah's ibadah, far away from iman, and he's just heedless and he's preoccupied in the dunya, and he has no, you know, remembrance of Allah at all. And so the jinn finds it easy to enter into such people. And really you find that most of this stuff, whether it's magic or sara', it always affects, you know, these kind of people who are far away from the deen, far away from tawheed, far away, you know, weak in their iman, and so on and so forth. And so this type of asara', this type of touch by the jinn, or this possession by the jinn which leads to paralysis and whatever else, then there are different types of it. The first one is what we call mas kulli, which is the all-inclusive touch. And this is when, for example, the jinn, he enters and he touches the whole of the body, right? All parts of the body. And this is what we call when a person becomes completely paralyzed. All his limbs become numb. He can't move. He stumbles. He falls and so on and so forth. He can't speak. Whatever. This is like what we call a complete effect upon the body. Then there is what we call the partial one, which is where maybe a limb will become paralyzed and it won't work anymore, or a leg or whatever. This is just the partial mass, the partial touch by the jinn. Then we also have that which lasts always. It never ceases being present. And then we have that one which only lasts for a few minutes and then it disappears, or which maybe lasts for a short while, but eventually it disappears. This is what we call the partial type of touch. So the point here that we should understand is that this type of al-mas is not the same as magic, but it is something that can nevertheless, it can affect a person. And there are ways that we can protect ourselves from this. So inshallah, I will now mention some of the ways of protection from asara, which is this, you know, being touched by the devil. And after this, we will move on to magic, and how to protect yourself from magic, both before it occurs and after it occurs. So anyway, how to protect yourself from asara? First of all, is to remember all of the adhkar, the sayings of the morning and the evening, the du'as that the Messenger, peace be upon him, alayhi salatu wasalam, used to say in the morning and the evening. And you will find them in the du'a books, the adhkar al-sabah wal-masa'. That's the first thing. Secondly, that whenever you jump from a high place, you're on a wall, or you're on a higher place and you're going to jump down, always say Bismillah. Say Bismillah. Right? Because you don't know what you could be landing upon. And often this is how people unknowingly, they cause harm to the jinn and their offspring and to their homes. Thirdly, that whenever you pour water anywhere, say Bismillah first. Say Bismillah first. Fourthly, that when you enter into a gloomy, dark type of room or a place or some gloomy, dark place, because these are the places where the jinn tend to reside and which they like, then always mention the name of Allah, Bismillah. Never ever do not harm a dog. A dog or a cat. It could be that do not go and harm, you know, kick a dog or harm a dog, because that could be, because as we know that the jinns can take on different forms. And the jinns can take the form of a dog, they can take the form of a snake, they can talk in different forms. So just be careful, don't harm, you know, you don't unwittingly harm something that, you know, could have a jinn within it. Try not to sleep on your own, right? Or try not to travel on your own. Don't travel on your own. Don't urinate. When you urinate, don't urinate in a place which looks like to be like, you know, like a living place or like a habitation, you know, and try not to, just be careful when where you urinate, if you have to urinate outside of your house. Also, don't go to deserted places by yourself. Don't just wander off by yourself, you know, in weird times, in deserted places where there is nobody. People tend to do that, and so you have to be careful of that, especially in the night as well. Also, when you throw something heavy upon the earth, when you take something and you throw it, say Bismillah, because you don't know where it's going to land, and you could harm, you could harm a jinn and his residence. When you enter the toilet, say Bismillah, and you say A'udhu billahi min al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith. And likewise, when you if you have children, always make ruqya upon your children, do the adhkar upon your children with the mu'awwadhatain. And the other verses in the Qur'an, what the messenger used to do to Al-Hasan Al-Husayn, used to put his hand upon their foreheads. U'idhukuma bikalimati Allahi tammati min sharri ma khalaq. I seek refuge for you both in Allah, in the perfect words of Allah, from everything, from every evil which he created. You do this ruqya upon your children, and you teach your children likewise to always, you know, recite Ayatul Kursi, or recite the Quls, have a habit of reciting the Quran, and so on and so forth. Likewise, when you have relations with your spouse, then there is a dua which you read, Bismillah, Allahumma jannibna shaytan wa jannibi shaytana mimma ma razaqtana. That, O Allah, in the name of Allah, O Allah, make shaitan distant from us, and make us distant from shaitan, and make shaitan distant from what you bestow upon us, meaning of offspring, of children. And likewise, when you sleep, make the du'as when you're supposed to sleep. So all of these are from the ways and means that basically protect you from being affected by as-sara. Okay, this now leads us to magic. So now we come back to magic. So the reason why I covered all of this is because all of these are connected issues. And, you know, whether we're speaking about the evil eye, whether it is just the as-sara, which is a possession, or magic, all of them are connected. And so we need to be aware of all of these. And the danger isn't just magic itself. There's something wider than magic. There is the evil eye. There is al-hasad, envy. There is as-sara. And so we need to be, you know, very careful from all of these different things. So as for the treatment of magic, which is what we were supposed to finish off last lesson, we didn't have time. So the treatment of magic, then, first of all, I should mention, the first thing is that the treatment of magic by magic is haram. It is haram. And this is one of the ways that people unfortunately fall into when they treat magic. And so the treatment of magic by magic, because magic itself is haram, so to resort to magic is itself also haram. And the scholars do not allow the treatment of magic by magic. And this is because the magician, as you already know, is already upon batil. He's obeying the devils. He's winning the assistance of the devils. And so to use magic, to repel magic, is just falling even more into that type of batil. And so this is why some of the scholars, they used to say that no one removes magic except a magician. Meaning that no one gets rid of magic with magic except a magician. Right? Because many people, you see that they'll quickly be able to get rid of magic in an instant, but, you know, overnight it'll just disappear. Well, that person's actually used magic, because he's used a stronger form of magic to repel the magic. So what happens is, you go to this person and he will say, right, I will cure you. Take your shirt off, leave it with me. Right, so we'll ask for your shirt. Right, this is a sign that he's going to be doing magic. So we'll take your shirt, and then he will do whatever he's doing. Really what he's doing is that he will then go, he will write a spell, he'll then invoke the jinn, a more powerful jinn, and he'll do even more acts of disbelief or disobedience or whatever else which is displeasing to Allah. And so the jinn will become even more happy with him. So they will then execute a more powerful form of magic. So then another jinn will be sent and dispatched off to that individual. This jinn will then kick out that first jinn. That jinn will then be kicked out. Right, he'll be taken out. And so that magic will appear to have ended. That's what it will appear to be. So that jinn will now, that magic will appear to be have stopped. He will no longer have that pain in his arm anymore because the jinn's now gone. Or will no longer have like the depression or whatever. He'll feel better. And then wait 2 or 3 weeks because the other jinn has now come. Then there'll be some other effect and some other symptom and some other problem. Right? So then maybe he'll have a pain in his leg. Or he'll have a pain in his back. Or maybe he'll have some other problem. So now he goes back to the magician again. And so now you see that this now becomes a play field for the magicians. And they steal the wealth of the people in this manner. And so this is what tends to happen when you treat magic with magic. And as I said, there are signs you can tell that someone is using magic to treat you. Even if they clothe it and conceal it with, you know, the Qur'an and so on and so forth. And we mentioned those things in the last lesson. I won't repeat them again. So this is treating magic by magic is haram. And also those people who use the jinn, they claim to use the jinn, or they claim to have the assistance of the jinn. We see that the scholars, I will read to you some of the verdicts of the scholars in this regard. First of all, from Sheikh Abdul Aziz Al-Rajhi, he was asked the question. He said, what is the ruling on using jinn, the righteous jinn, in order to remove magic? What is the ruling? And the Shaykh said, first of all, it is not desirable to use the jinn at all. Absolutely. And the reason is because we do not know the condition of the jinn. You know, the jinn, they come and they speak and they basically, we don't have any evidence to show that this jinn is in fact what he says he is. He could be a munafiq. He could be a rafid. He could be a shia. Could be a rafid. Because the jinn, amongst them are believers, disbelievers. Amongst them there are shia. Amongst them there are sufis. Amongst them there are, all sorts of qadaris, jahmis, all sorts of deviant sects amongst them. Just as the jinn themselves mentioned in Surah Al-Jinn. The jinn, when you read Surah Al-Jinn, they mention that we are of many different paths and persuasions. And so a jinn comes along and he says, I'm a Muslim, I'm righteous, I'll help you, whatever. But we have no evidence about whether he's speaking the truth or not. We can't see him. He could be a munafiq, he could be a mubtadi, an innovator, he could be a rafidi, a shia, could be whatever. And all he wants to do is to win the confidence of this healer so that he can slowly misguide him and, fool him and deceive him and over time lead him into falsehood. And so anyone who opens himself up to the jinn and assistance with the jinn, he is putting himself in a great danger without even realizing. And the jinn are more smarter than any magician. So anyway, the Shaykh, he says, he goes on to explain that the jinn, we don't know their condition, we don't know what they're like, we don't know whether they're truthful, and we've got no evidence. And in fact, there's a really good answer here from Shaykh Al-Albani, rahimahullah. And so he was asked the same question. He said, look, basically, seeking aid from the jinn, and is it possible, is it possible? So he said, listen to his answer. He said that this question is wrong. This whole question is wrong. The question should be that first of all, dividing the jinn into righteous and unrighteous and a believer and a kafir, first of all, this is correct. Because in reality, there are righteous and unrighteous jinn and believing and disbelieving jinn. However, that knowledge is in the knowledge of the unseen, and that is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is true. As it relates to us, we don't have that knowledge. Even though we acknowledge that yes, there are righteous jinn and there are evil jinn. But as it relates to us, then we do not have that knowledge. Right? We don't have that knowledge. And so in relation to us, this distinction between them is meaningless because we don't know. And the Shaykh gives a beautiful example. He says, let's say, for example, some guy came along to you and he said, I'm a Muslim. You've never seen him before. You don't know who he is. He just come out of nowhere. You've never seen him before. You don't know him. And he says to you, I'm a righteous Muslim. I want to do business with you. Let's set up a business. Now you, the first thing you want to say, well, wait a minute. I don't even know you. I don't know who you are, where you've come from, what you're about. You know, I need to find out who you are. I need to find out what you're about. I need to know your background. And so there's no way you are going to do business with that individual. Right? So the Shaykh says, look, this is the normal habit of a sane person. This is how he would react when someone comes, he doesn't know him. This is how we would behave. And yet, when it comes to a jinn, you know, you hear voices from behind a wall or from a person, and you know, he starts telling you, yes, I'm a righteous jinn, I'm going to help you. You know, I'm your friend, you're a righteous man, you're a righteous person, I'm a righteous jinn. You know, how foolish is it for a man to start believing that, yes, indeed, this jinn is telling the truth? You know, when the jinn are the most lying and deceitful of people. And so this is why the scholars of hadith, they used to say that if a jinn narrates a hadith, we cannot accept that hadith because his integrity is not established. Unlike men, whose integrity and honesty and truthfulness we know, when they narrate that the messenger said such and such, then obviously we can evaluate them, we can check for their honesty and their integrity and their memory, and we can believe, and we can take it, and we can say, yes, this hadith is authentic. But as for a jinn, then his adala, his integrity and his trustworthiness cannot be established by any means at all. And so therefore the hadith of the jinn are rejected. And so you never see any of the scholars narrating a hadith from, you know, from a jinn. So for that reason, these people who claim that we use the jinn and we seek the jinn as a means because they are our friends and they help us and they aid us and they assist us, and this man is a deceived man. This man is deceived. He's deceived. Be not under any doubt about that. And so. So this is the wrong way of going about treating magic. And again, in the last lesson, I mentioned to you many signs of someone who is actually involved in magic. So you should beware of that, and you should avoid all of that. And this now moves us on to the issue of treating magic in the right way. And so the right way, first of all, is there are two situations. The first of which is treating magic before it occurs. And so with respect to that, we have a number of steps that a Muslim can take. And so from those steps that a Muslim can take, find where it's gone. So as I said, the first period is before you actually get affected by the jinn. And so in this regard, there are 9 or 10 different steps that can be taken by a believer. And here we are. So from those steps, that a believer can take. Well, in fact, first of all, there's a separate issue that we should discuss, is that we find that those who are most likely to be affected by jinn and by magic and by all these types of things are those people who are far, far away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَعْشُ عَنْ ذِكْرِ الرَّحْمَانِ نُقَيِّدْ لَهُ شَيْطَانًا فَهُوَ لَهُ قَرِينٌ. That whoever lives a life away from the remembrance of Ar-Rahman, of Allah, then we will appoint for him a devil, and this devil then will become a companion to him. Right? So first of all, just being away from Allah, being away from Allah's dhikr, being away from Allah's tawheed, worshipping Allah upon tawheed, and you know, not remembering Allah, this is something that invites the shayateen upon you. That's the first thing. Second thing is that when Iblis made that promise, when he said, "Qala fa bi izzatika la ughwiyannahum ajma'in illa ibadaka minhumul mukhlasin." And when Iblis said to Allah that by your might and by your power I will misguide them all, but he made an exception. He said, "Illa ibadaka minhumul mukhlasin," except for those servants who have ikhlas. And ikhlas, having sincerity, what this ikhlas means here is refers to two things. The first thing is to make your worship only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your bowing, your prostrating, your sacrifice, your fear, your hope, your love, your isti'ana, the seeking of aid, your istighatha, the seeking of rescue, your tawakkul, all these things are only directed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And secondly, when you direct these acts of worship to Allah, you are sincere in those acts of worship, meaning that you are seeking Allah's reward, you are seeking Allah's pleasure, not the pleasure of men. You're not seeking some worldly benefit, you're not seeking some, you know, that your intentions are sincere and pure, and it is done for the sake of Allah. Right? These two things, when a believer is characterized in his ibadah by these two things, then these are the people whom shaitan has said he will not have any control or power over them, and he cannot misguide them. And likewise, Allah said in another verse, "Inna ibadi, indeed my servants, laysa laka alayhim sultan, illa man ittaba'aka min al-ghawin." So Allah said, "Indeed my servants, you don't have any authority over them. My servants, my ibad." And Allah's servants, the ibad, are those who give ubudiyya to Allah, meaning that they give servitude and are enslaved only to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not to others besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you see that shaitan knows that tawheed is something over which he cannot gain ascendance from these verses. So the people who are away from that, they are the ones who will be prone to being affected by magic and so on and so forth. So anyway, what can a person do to protect himself from the effects of magic and being afflicted? Well, first of all, I should mention there are four things. Al-Iman, which is having faith in Allah, and the pillars of Iman, Allah, His angels, His books, His messengers, the last day, and Al-Qadr. And knowing Al-Iman in detail, meaning knowing the belief in Allah. What is the belief in Allah? Belief that He's the Lord over all things. Belief in His names and attributes. Belief in His right to be worshipped alone. Right? Having that knowledge in a detailed sense, because that knowledge enters the heart and it fills the heart, right? And then it creates the emotions in the heart like love and fear and hope. So when the heart becomes filled with this, it becomes difficult for the jinn and the shayateen to enter a person's heart. So if you have an empty vessel, the jinn can enter. If you have a full vessel full of iman, then the jinn will not enter, right? So the first thing is al-iman. Second thing is at-tawheed. Pure monotheism, worshipping Allah alone, and to have knowledge of Tawheed in its details, and to know Shirk in its details, and to know the dividing line, and to avoid Shirk, and to, you know, be firm upon Tawheed. Well, you can see this from the Qur'an, the shaitan has no authority over the people of Tawheed. Third thing, Al-Ikhlas, sincerity in one's actions. That you do actions for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The proof of that again is the verse that we mentioned earlier on, where Iblis made an exception for those who are mukhlaseen. The fourth thing is at-taqwa. At-taqwa, which is to be have piety, which is to worship, which is to obey Allah in the things which He commanded, and to keep away from those things which He prohibited, and to act upon that with one's, you know, in one's speech, in one's action. So these are four things. Al-Iman, At-Tawheed, Al-Ikhlas, and At-Taqwa. These are things that a person should generally have and be strong upon. That's the first thing. Second thing is nextly at-tawakkul, having tawakkul upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَزْبُهُ. That whoever places his trust upon Allah, then he will be sufficient for him. So tawakkul is one of the greatest forms of worship, that he resigns his affairs to Allah and relies in his heart upon Allah. The third thing is to be firm upon all of the supplications in the morning and the evening. If you find a good book on supplications and you see what the messenger used to recite in the morning and the evening, then you repeat that every day. This is a means of protection for you, and it is like a fortress for you. And from the things you can read is surah, is the three quls. Qul huwallahu ahad, qul a'udhu birabbil falaq, qul a'udhu birabbin nas, in the morning and in the evening, and this is a protection for you. Fourthly, to read suratul Baqarah in the house. Because Surah Al-Baqarah as a whole, the messenger said that the house in which Surah Al-Baqarah is recited, then the shaitan cannot come close to it. Fifthly, that you maintain the du'as when you enter the toilet and when you leave the toilet. A'udhu billahi min al-khubthi wal-khaba'ith. Fifthly, that you recite Ayatul Kursi when you go to sleep. As the messenger said, that when you read Ayatul Kursi, then he is given a protection. He is given protection by way of the angels, so that the shayateen cannot, you know, come close to him. Likewise, to say the following: La ilaha illallah, وَحْدَهُ لَا شَرِيكَ لَهُ لَهُ الْمُلْكُ وَلَهُ الْحَمْدُ وَهُوَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ 100 times in a day. Because the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, he said that whoever recites this 100 times in a day, he will have the reward of freeing 10 slaves. The reward of freeing 10 slaves. And he will have 100 rewards written for him of good deeds. And he will have 100 evil deeds erased for him. And it will be a protection for him from shaitan for that day. Right? So that is something from the sunnah which is authentic, that he will be protected up until he reaches the evening. And also to say the supplications when you enter a house and when you leave a house. When you enter a house and when you leave the house. To say Bismillah when you enter the house. Tawakkaltu ala Allah. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. When a person, when he leaves the house, and likewise when he enters the house, that he maintains these supplications. Also, that he can make use of Al-Ajwa. The dates known as Al-Ajwa. These are a particular type of date which are found, not just in Medina, but in many different places. But the dates which are in Medina, which are Al-Ajwa dates in Medina, they are the most superior. They are the best. And so the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, he said, whoever in the morning he eats 7 dates which are from the Ajwa of Al-Madina, then he will not be harmed by any magic, nor any poisonous sting. That's, to have Ajwa dates is something that you can use as a preventative measure. And as for being affected by magic, once you are affected by magic, then we take the following steps. We'll mention them quickly, inshallah ta'ala, as we come to a close. So from those steps a person can take, this is after you've been affected by magic, then as we said before, we should understand that magic, when a person is afflicted by it, is just simply a trial, like many of the other trials in life. When a person, maybe he loses some wealth, maybe he loses someone in the family, maybe he has an illness, maybe he has a calamity. These are just trials that Allah puts in the path of the believers. And likewise, when you become afflicted by magic, that is a type of trial, a type of oppression. And again, it is from Allah's decree, from Allah's qadr. And so a believer should know and be equipped and understand the ways and means he has at his disposal, which he can use to treat this trial. So from those ways, first of all, if it is possible for you to find out where the magic is, what is the source of the magic, if it is possible for you to find out, you are encouraged to find out. Right? Because one of the ways to destroy magic is to find where the magic has been done, whatever it's been written or whatever it's been buried, and to take it and to destroy it. Right? So this is something recommended. If you can do that, then try to do that. As for when the jinn tells you, because sometimes often the jinn will tell you, when a person is making ruqya and the jinn tells you that, oh yes, the magic is in such and such a place, then it is not permissible to believe everything they say. And if they say that the magic is in such and such a place, then you may want to make verification. There's nothing wrong with making verification, right, to see that if it's the truth. Because sometimes the jinn, they do tell you where the magic has been done. Right? And sometimes they do speak the truth, even though they are great liars. Right? So in that case, you make the thabbut, you make verification. Right? So first of all, you try to find the actual magic if you can, whether it's in the land or the sea or in your house, whatever, and to get it and to destroy it. And the way you destroy it is that if it's written, it's on a piece of paper, if it's written, you put it in some, you read some ruqya upon some water, you take some water, pure water, can be zamzam or whatever, read upon it, read Ayatul Kursi, read the 3 quls, read the verses of magic, the verse of the Harut and Marut and the other verses of Musa alayhi salam and the Fir'aun, the magicians of Fir'aun, and do ruqya upon that water. Then you take that magic, that paper, whatever is written, and put it in the water and basically erase it. Just erase it. And then after that, you just destroy it and you get rid of it in a place where, it's not going to affect anybody. That's the first thing. If you can do that, alhamdulillah, this will take a major step in getting rid of the magic. If you can't do that, if you do not know the place of the... Now obviously I want to make a distinction here now, because there is one thing when you do a ruqya upon a person and the jinn speaks, and through that the jinn just says that the magic is in such and such a place. This is one thing, right? But it is another thing for somebody else now to just invoke the jinn separately. to invoke the jinn separately, to for them to tell him where is the magic. This now is the use of the jinn and seeking assistance of the jinn, and that is not permissible. That is not permissible, right? So the point that we're making is that if in the case of reading the ruqya, a jinn tells you the magic is in such a place, then make tathabbut, verify it. But as for now, someone comes to you and says, oh, we've got magic done, can you find, you know, can you tell us? And this person goes away and says, yes, I'll go and I'll find it from my jinn. This is not lawful, this is not permissible. Because this type of interaction with the jinn is not permissible. Anyway, so that's the first thing. If this is not possible, if this is not possible for you to do, and in most cases it's not possible, then the second thing is, then the most effective method is to use the Qur'an, and to use the ruqya, and to use the dua, and all of the various other things that we're going to, inshallah, mention now. And, this is the tools and the weapons that a believer has been given in order to treat the magic. So, from those things that a person can do is, first of all, to abandon all of the sins and to make tawbah. To make tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for his sins, for his disobedience, for his negligence, for him falling short, and to make sincere tawbah, to make istighfar, and to ask Allah to forgive him, and use those times, like in the last third of the night, to make tawbah to Allah and to ask for forgiveness, and to be and to fulfill the conditions of repentance. Right? The conditions of repentance are three or four. First of all, you must immediately cease that evil deed. Secondly, you must feel remorseful and sorry for having fallen into it. And thirdly, you must have a firm resolve not to fall into it again. And fourthly, if it involved the right of somebody else, meaning that the sin you did involved harming somebody else in his wealth and his honor and his life, that you return that right that you took from him. Right? So this is the conditions of a repentance. So you repent from all the deeds that you're falling into. This is the first thing that you can do. Right? Because we believe in general that every single calamity that befalls you, it is from your own, what your own hands have earned. This is a general rule that the scholars explain from the verses in the Quran, that all calamities that come to mankind are from what their own hands earn of evil. And this includes tribulations, calamities, harms, illnesses, diseases, death, and likewise magic is from one of those things. So tawbah is the first thing. After this, there are other things that can be used, other ways and means that can be used, and from them is honey, al-asal, honey in the Quran. We see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he has mentioned in the Quran, we see the verse in Surah An-Nahl. Allah mentions a verse about the bees, how Allah has inspired the bees. He mentions about this drink, which is of different colors, and he says, "Fihi shifa'un lin-nas, inna fi dhalika la'ayatin liqawmin yatafakkarun." That this liquid of different colors, within it is a cure and a healing for the people. And indeed, in this are signs for a people who reflect. And likewise, the messenger said, "Alaykum bishifa'ain, al-asal wal-Qur'an." Upon you are the two healings, the two cures, honey and the Qur'an. And likewise, the messenger said in another hadith, "Ash-shifa'u fi thalathin," that healing is in three things: a drink of honey, and likewise, a hijama, which is the hijama, which is the bloodletting, the letting, taking the blood out of the body, and thirdly, cauterization with the fire. So, in other words, he's mentioned honey and hijama in this hadith. And from the best of the honey that one can have is what we call the sidr honey. A sidr. This is a tree which gives like red berries, red oranges type of bellies. It has a certain like green type of leaf. It is an evergreen tree, and it grows in hot climates. And so there's a honey that is produced from that. You find it in Yemen, in fact. Yemeni sidr honey is apparently is the best, most effective. But the leaves as well, it's also known as the lote tree. And these leaves, you can use them, and some of the scholars like Sheikh Ibn Baz, they mentioned that you can take some of the leaves. Inshallah, we will come, in fact, that is mentioned a bit later on. I'll come on to that in a short while, inshallah. So the use of honey is, again, one of the ways that you can actually treat the effects of magic. The second is the black seed, al-habbat al-sawda. And this black seed is something that is mentioned in the statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said that upon you is this black seed, عليكم بهذه الحبة السوداء حبة السوداء فإن فيها شفاء من كل داء إلا الصام. that upon you is this black seed, for within it is a cure for every disease, with the exception of death. And so the scholars, we see that the scholars have recommended the use of this black seed, and to take its oil and to do ruqya upon its oil, upon the black seed oil, and then to rub it upon where the pain is or upon the rest of the body. And this is one of the ways that we find being done amongst the with the scholars. Also from it is olive oil, the oil of the olive. And so we see in the Quran Allah has described the olive tree, shajaratun mubarakatun zaytuna, the blessed tree, the blessed olive tree. And Allah swore by what tini was zaytun, by the fig and the olive. He swore by that, by the fig and the olive. And we see this also mentioned by the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, recommending the use of oil, that eat or take the oil of the olive, and you know, use it in your food, for indeed it is from a blessed tree. And so we see again from what the scholars do is that they use the olive oil as part of the ruqya, and they read over it, the ruqya from the Quran, and then they use it on the place of magic or on the body. And so this is one of the ways of doing ruqya. So that is another thing that a person can use himself to treat himself. Also, fourthly, the water of Zamzam, ma'u Zamzam. Because the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that the water of Zamzam is khayru ma'in ala wajhil ard, that it is the best water on the face of the earth, is the water of Zamzam, that within it there is food, nourishment, and within it there is a healing for disease. And this hadith is authentic. And so also in another hadith the Messenger said that the water of Zamzam is for whatever it is drunk for. This means that when you drink the water of Zamzam and you bring a certain intention and a certain motive, you know, behind it. So you say that you drink Zamzam, and in your mind you want to increase in your iman, and you want to increase in your ibadah, and you know, whatever it is you wish and your desire, then the water of Zamzam is for that. You know, meaning that it is whatever it is drunk for. So this means that you can use the water of Zamzam as part of the treatment for magic. So if you drink water of Zamzam with your intention being for the removal of that magic and the weakening of that magic and the destruction of that magic, then the water of Zamzam is something that will help and aid in the removal of that magic. Also from the ways and means is the use of, as we said, the sidr, the leaves of the sidr, the lot tree, right? And so the Shaykh Ibn Baz rahimahullah, he's mentioned a particular type of ruqya which involves these leaves. And so what you do, I'll mention it very briefly, he says basically this is found from experience to be very effective, from experience. And so what the Shaykh mentioned rahimahullah, he said that he takes 7 leaves from the sidr tree, from the lot tree. You take these 7 leaves, you crush those leaves, and then you put them in, it has to be like a large container, and then you take a large amount of water, it has to be something like 20 liters of water, and then you put that water into the crushed leaves, and then with that, then upon that water you recite the following ruqya. First of all, a'udhu billahi as-sami'ul 'alim minash shaitanir rajim, bismillahir rahmanir rahim, and surah al-fatiha 7 times. Then a'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim, followed by ayatul kursi 7 times. Ayatul kursi 7 times. Then you read the last 3 verses of suratul baqara. The last 3 verses of suratul baqara. Lillahi ma fis samawati wa ma fil ard, wa in tubdu ma fi anfusikum aw tukhfuhu yuhasibkum bihi Allah. To the end of surah al-baqara. So you recite that, once. And then you recite, there are certain passages in the Quran that relate to the magic done by the magicians of Fir'aun. And there are 3 passages in the Quran, right? You recite those 3 passages. Now, if you want to know where these verses are, I'll give you a reference. In fact, there are 2 PDF articles which were placed on the web today, early this afternoon. The web address is dajjal.com, dajjal jinn.com/liar?GZINC If you type that into your internet browser at home, you will find an article, and within there you will be able to download two PDF documents. In the first PDF document, you will find 47 passages from the Qur'an. 47 passages from the Qur'an, all from the Qur'an, like as in you will have to read it as if it's the Qur'an, which are highly effective and which are used by the scholars to treat magic in general. 47 verses, right? And then the second file you can download contains those parts in the Qur'an that relate specifically to the magic of the magicians. Right? So it mentions the verse of Harut and Marut. It mentions the passages in the Quran that speak about how Musa alayhi salam, he overcame the magic of the magicians of the Fir'aun. Because those passages are very effective in combating magic. Very effective in combating magic. So anyway, so coming back to where we were, we said, remember, that the next thing you read upon these sidr leaves in the water is those passages in the Quran which speak of Musa al-Islam defeating the magic of the magicians. Alright, and there are three passages. They are in, if you remember, Surah Al-A'raf, and Surah Yunus, and one of the other surahs, I don't recall the exact reference, but basically you will find it in that PDF article. You will find the references in that PDF article. Surah Shu'ara, I believe, Surah 26, verse 79 onwards. So you read those three passages, then you read Surah Ikhlas, قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ السَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ وَلَمْ يَكُنْ لَهُ كُفُوًا أَحَدٌ. You read that 7 times. Then you read Surah Al-Falaq 7 times. Then you read Surah An-Nas, the last surah in the Quran, 7 times. Then you read Surah Al-Kafirun, and you read that 7 times. Then you read the verse in Surah Ali Imran, قُلِ اللَّهُمَّ مَالِكُ الْمُلْكِ تُؤْتِي الْمُلْكَ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتَنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ وَتُنْزِعُ الْمُلْكَ مِمَّنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُعِزُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ وَتُذِلُّ مَنْ تَشَاءُ بِيَدِكَ الْخَيْرُ إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. And you read this 7 times. So anyway, there are a number of other things that you read. There's actually quite a bit more. Whoever wants this information, you can come to me afterwards, or I can point to you where it is. But basically, what you're doing is that you're reading this ruqya, which involves all of these verses from the Quran upon this water. Then what you do is you can drink that water and you can bathe yourself in that water. You can bathe yourself in that water. And this, from experience, has been proven to be very effective in combating the effects of magic. And one thing I should point out here as well is that just like humans, like for example, there are certain things which are harmful to us. Like for example, if you were to smell ammonia, you'd have to get out very quickly because it's going to make you go unconscious. Or if you were to smell some thick black smoke, it's going to really harm you unless you go away. So there are certain things which, as humans, we are harmed by. Likewise, the jinns themselves, there are many things by which they are harmed by. And so often those types of things are used in the ruqya as a result of making it very hard and difficult upon the jinn. So from those things are things like, you know, the water of Zamzam and reciting of the Quran, and likewise some of these things like the sidr, the leaf of the sidr tree. And so this is how, you know, this is able to combat the jinn and make the jinn to leave your body. So anyway, this is the fifth thing that was mentioned about the as-sidr, the leaves of the sidr. And the sixth thing is mentioned here is as-sina. As-sina is a type of seed. It's similar to, you know, like a cumin seed or a fennel seed. It's one of those type of seeds. And the Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in a hadith that if there was anything in which there was a cure for death, it would have been a sinner. Right, so this seed is also something in which we find in the Sunnah that it has been given, it is described as having healing properties. And so what you do with this seed is that you bring this seed to a boil, you bring it to a boil, and then from the water will turn like a yellowy colour, and from this you boil it in like a litre of water, and then after that you can basically drink it. You can also mix it with honey, and you can, you know, drink it as well. And so this is another one of the ways and means that you can use. The seventh thing that you can use is al-hijama. Al-hijama is what we call cupping, the bloodletting, where you use those cups and you withdraw the blood. And so the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, he actually mentioned in a hadith, that whoever had hijama done upon him on the 17th night, or on the 19th night, or the 21st night of the month, meaning the Islamic month, then it will be a cure for him from every disease. Right? So al-hijama is something that is, again, is from the prophetic medicine, and it's from the powerful ways and means of removing the effects of just illness in general, and likewise magic in particular as well. And so, again, with hijama, with bloodletting, there are certain days in which it is disliked, like, you know, Wednesdays and Saturdays, and there are certain days in which if you can do it, it is the best day to do it, like the 17th, 19th, and the 21st of the month. And so this is the seventh thing that you can use. And finally, the eighth thing that you can use is ad-du'a, which is supplication. Of course, all of this is on top of the fact that you can use the Qur'an as a ruqya. Right? These are all measures on top of the Qur'an, which we use as a ruqya. So ad-du'a is from the greatest of the signs, from the greatest of the ways. And the du'a, which is made to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, you seek those times and moments in which the du'a is answered, like the last third of the night. And likewise, for example, on the day of Friday, the hour before Maghrib, after Asr, just before Maghrib, in that time when, you know, Allah responds to the du'a. Likewise, between the Adhan and the Iqamah. And likewise, between the time that when the Imam is doing the Jummah Khutbah and he sits down for a short pause and he stands up again, in that time, there are many times in which du'a is, you know, acceptable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And especially when you are someone who is madhloom, you are oppressed by having magic done upon you, then as we find in the Sunnah, that the du'a of the oppressed and of the oppressed person is never returned. Meaning that the one who is oppressed, who is madhloom, and he makes du'a to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah responds to him. So du'a is from the most powerful of means and methods. It is done when you call upon Allah with yaqeen and with conviction and with iman. Okay. However, many people, they say, yeah, I made du'a to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and nothing happened. I read the Quran and nothing happened, whatever. You see many people saying this. And the thing is that du'a is answered, right, as long as the certain barriers are absent. Because there are certain barriers which prevent a person's du'a from being answered. And from those barriers are that a person is eating from the haram. By eating from the haram, you're eating from the haram. Or you are taking bribes. Or you are consuming riba. You're involved in riba, usury. All of these things are what prevent a person from being answered. And likewise, a person is drinking from the haram. He's drinking which is haram. Drinking khumur, drinking intoxicants. Drinking wine, drinking alcohol. Taking drugs. Taking in, you know, tablets and pills and whatever else. This also prevents a person from his du'a being answered. Wearing that which is haram, having haram clothes, you know, like a man wearing silk and a man wearing gold, right? And a woman, you know, not wearing properly in the way that she should be wearing as a Muslimah. And all of this is from the, you know, the things which prevent a person's du'a from being answered. Likewise, being nourished by that which is haram, meaning that when you earn for yourself and your family that nourishment that you're receiving, again, it is from the haram. And all of these four things are mentioned in that hadith, that well-known hadith, where a man, the Messenger said, a man comes, he's on a journey, his hair is disheveled, he raises his hands up to the sky, and he calls upon his Lord, and he says, "Oh Allah, oh Allah," and, you know, "My Lord, my Lord." And the Messenger said, however, his food is haram, his drink is haram, his clothing is haram, his nourishment is haram, how then will he be answered? Right? So du'a, when we speak of du'a, then your du'a must be free from any barriers that stop it from being answered. And likewise, the fifth part of it is that a person must not have ta'ajjal. He must not be hasty, meaning that I called upon Allah, he never responded to me. I spent the whole night yesterday from 12 till Fajr making dua and nothing's happened. This is ta'ajjal. You know, we see sometimes the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used to suffer problems for tens of years. Look at the story of Ya'qub alayhi salam with his children. Look at the story of Ayyub and his illness, right? And so that's the type of patience. And people nowadays, they want the answer in the morning. They want the fix in the morning. They want the cure in the morning. They want it next week, you know. And so this ta'ajjul, be hasty, this is something that itself prevents your dua from being answered. So you have to have sabr. You have to have sabr. And so anyway, so this is from the greatest of the ways and means by which magic is repelled. So you see, all of these things are from the sunnah. This is what the messenger has taught us. This is what each and every individual, he should be self-reliant, independent, take it upon himself, stand upon his own two feet, increase himself in his iman, in tawheed, and use all these ways and means. And by Allah's permission, as Allah says, إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ إِنَّ كَيْدَ الشَّيْطَانِ كَانَ ضَعِيفًا, that indeed, the plot of shaitan is weak. It's weak. And when a person gathers all of these things together and brings all these things together, combines all of these things together, he will find that the magic, you know, inshallah ta'ala, the magic will be cured by Allah's permission. But we see that most people, unfortunately, we see a mindset that first of all, generally people are far away from the religion. Their iman is weak. They don't understand tawheed and what is shirk. They don't adhere to the sunnah. They rely upon other people. You know, as soon as the problem comes, ring up so-and-so, he'll sort it out for us. This is like relying upon other people and not really relying upon their own iman in Allah. And this weakness is something that is why these problems are so widespread. Because people are not prepared to, you know, stand on their own two feet and use the ways and means. And, you know, to protect themselves and to ward off this evil from themselves. So, with that, we come to an end. We come to a close of this session. And inshallah ta'ala, hope that this has been of some benefit to us and a reminder to us. And we should beware, as I said in closing, that we be aware of those people who are the liars and the fraudsters and the swindlers and the cheats. Those maybe who are in it for the money. And maybe those people who may be not in it for the money, but nevertheless, they still fall into that which is incorrect when it comes to treating people, when it comes to doing ruqya, when it comes to being involved with the jinn. All of these things should be avoided. And a Muslim should take it upon himself to inform himself about his deen, about his Lord, about iman in a detailed sense, about tawheed in a detailed sense, about what is obligatory upon him, about these ways and means that he can use, the adhkar, the verses in the Quran, and so on and so forth. And once a person, you know, once a person stands up on his own two feet in this manner, then the signal will be given to those jinn or to those who are doing the magic, that it's going to become very difficult and hard for the magic to start affecting this person from now on. Right? This is how it really ought to be working. And so with that, inshallah ta'ala, we come to a close. If there are any questions on anything that's been said, or any corrections, if anybody has, then inshallah, we have a short time before we leave. Before we have to break, I think we have to leave the building at 8:45, I believe, again. Yeah, so, okay, we've got a short time again. So we'll try to go through these questions as quickly as possible, inshallah ta'ala. But as I said, I recommend that you go to that address I gave to you earlier on. You will find two files. One is 18 pages long, one is 3 pages long. And you will find all the verses in one place together, which you can take, which you can read. You can print it off and have it with you. You can read it on a daily basis. And inshallah, this is something that you should do. So it's, again, for the listeners, I'll mention it again. Go to www.dajjal, which is spelled dajjal.com/liar, which is LIAR, / again, then a question mark, and then GZINC. And there you will find two PDF files, one which has 47 passages from the Quran, one which has about 5 or 6. And those two, you should try to memorize. I recommend that you try to memorize from them what you already know, what you don't know, sorry. And some of them you'll already know, like Ayatul Kursi and Surah Al-Fatiha and things like that. But the rest you should try to memorize. So that will help you, inshallah ta'ala, as in general. And so we have some questions, inshallah ta'ala. Again, we are very short on time, so we have to try to get through them as very quickly as possible. So again, I apologize. We would like to have spent more time on the questions, but because there was so much material, I had to rush through it really. Then we're going to have to really do a quick fire on some of these questions. So, okay, very quickly, a question just generally upon witches on brooms and Halloween and origins of Halloween and You know, there is nothing. There's nothing ascribed to the Prophet alayhi salam regarding witches who roam around on brooms. I don't know where this has come from. There's no such statement, as far as we know, that is ascribed to the Prophet alayhi salam. As for Halloween, then it is a ritual and a festivity of the pagans, and so we have nothing to do with the pagans and their festivities. And all of these things we keep away from. We have no connection to them. We're not involved in them. We don't partake in them. If they knock on your door, we don't open the door. We don't give them anything. We have nothing to do with any of these types of festivities. And all of these festivities in general that you find the non-Muslims which are involved in, you find that always somewhere along the line that they have a pagan origin. Whether that is birthdays, whether that is Halloween, whether that is Valentine's Day, whatever you want to, you know, whatever it is, we only have two celebrations as Muslims. We have Eid al-Fitr, we have Eid al-Adha. And then we have the Friday, which is a day of Eid, every week. That's all we know as Muslims. Anything besides that, then there's nothing of the sort at all. As for the Eid Milad al-Nabi, as they claim, this again is something that was invented in the 6th century after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The companions never knew it, Abu Bakr never knew it, Umar never knew it, Uthman never knew it, Ali never knew it, none of the companions knew it, neither the Muhajireen, nor the Ansar, nor the majority of the Sahaba, nor the Tabi'een, or the Tabi'een, nor the Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, Imam Shafi, Imam Ahmed, none of them knew it at all. It was invented by the Shia, the Rafidi Shia, in the 6th or 7th century, and it's just a mere imitation of the non-Muslims, and it is just a means to keep the people away from their religion and to believe that by, you know, respecting and the Prophet in this way once in a year, that this is somehow going to bring them salvation. This is not the way of the Muslims. The Muslims, they know that to please Allah, it is to follow the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in belief and in deed. This is how we earn the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So anyway, all of these celebrations, they have nothing to do with Islam. We only know two celebrations, the two Eids, and the other one, which is the Yom al-Jum'ah, which is the Eid every week. Right? This is all that we know as Muslims. Just a general question on ruqya. Can you perform ruqya upon a person who has had black magic done upon them? Of course you can. You can read ruqya upon a person as a good deed that you are doing to that person. And in general, the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in a hadith, what the scholars explain, that for you to ask somebody to do ruqya upon you is something that is discouraged, because it is a sign of the imperfection in a person's tawheed. So generally speaking, you should try not to ask someone to make ruqya for you. However, if someone does ruqya upon you from his own choice, then this hamla is a good deed. It is a good deed. You are helping an oppressed person. You are aiding him. So for you to voluntarily do ruqya upon somebody else without you even being asked, then yes, alhamdulillah, this is a praiseworthy deed. This is a good deed. So yes, you can do ruqya upon a person who has had magic done upon them without them even asking you. And secondly, can any person do the ruqya? Well, alhamdulillah, every person should be able to, you know, if they can recite the Qur'an, first of all, they should be doing ruqya, as in upon themselves, as we see in the sunnah, reading Ayatul Kursi when you go to sleep, this is ruqya. Reading the three quls, this is ruqya. So, alhamdulillah, a believer, you know, who has iman, and, you know, there's no harm in them doing ruqya upon themselves as a habit, as part of his ibadah, and so on and so forth, and then they can do it upon somebody else. But as for when it is involves, like, you know, case of magic and the jinn, then really someone who is of strong faith, of strong iman, is firm in his knowledge, he's grounded in tawheed and the sunnah, then that kind of person, and he only uses the correct ways and correct means, then that is the person that should be doing ruqya upon people who are afflicted with cases of magic that need to be looked at, you know, seriously, and need to be treated. But in general, you can do ruqya upon yourself, you can do ruqya upon your children, you can do ruqya upon your husband, upon your wife, upon your parents, whatever. And a person should be in a habit of doing this anyway, because it is from the preventative measures. Is there anything else apart from reading to protect ourselves? Yes, all of that was covered in the lesson. Okay, another question about someone having had magic done upon them whilst they were abroad, and they found the magic, they disposed of the magic in the correct way, but they fear that because some of their parts like hairs and nails and things like that might still be present, that they fear that the magic might still be done, and so does this magic have to be found, or can ruqya and tahseen and protection, from Allah, with Allah, be sufficient? Obviously, if you can't find the source of the magic, then you rely upon those ways and means that we covered. And so those ways and means, if you use them, you combine them, all of them together, to put as much opposition against that magic, then inshallah ta'ala, with Allah's permission, then the magic will be treated. So you stick to those ways and means, yes, in the absence of knowing exactly where the magic is. How do you know if someone has something has been done to you, as many people after hearing stories get paranoid? Is there is there a genuine person that that someone could go to get a definitive answer? The way that you normally tell if something has been done upon you is that you have ruqya done upon you, the Quran is recited upon you, and someone who is generally skilled knows and is firm in his belief and iman and has knowledge of tawheed and the sunnah, and he sees certain signs from you. There are certain signs that are an indication, can be a combined indication, that magic has been done upon you. And from those signs, sometimes it can be that maybe your eyes start rolling, or maybe your hands start twitching, maybe you feel a numbness in one of your limbs and you can't move them. And there are many little, you start feeling a pain in your head, like pressing downward. There are many signs that basically are a sign that this is not like a normal thing that you're suffering from. Maybe it's actually as a result of magic. And so, but at the same time, yes, many people, they do get paranoid. And sometimes you have to try and distinguish between something which might be an effect of magic and something which also at the same time is your mind, is your emotion and your mind being involved as well. Because even those people who are affected with magic, once it comes to their knowledge that they are affected with magic, then the mind, once it becomes aware that magic has been done upon them, that can also start being affected now. And so many of the things that they experience can actually just be an emotional, psychological reaction, like suddenly feeling anxious or this, whatever. So sometimes you find like a confusion between the two things. So yes, to answer your question, sometimes many of the things that you perceive to be from magic might not actually be from magic. It might be something else. Might be just explainable. Can you take black seed oil when a woman is pregnant? From what I'm informed of, from what I am told, that it is not recommended for a woman to have too much black seed oil. To have too much black seed oil whilst she is pregnant. As for using it in moderation, in small amounts, then that, inshallah ta'ala, would not be harmful. But taking it excessively, from what I'm aware of, and from what I've been told, and from what I am aware of, that this can be harmful. A friend of mine and her husband were told to wear a vest for 24 hours, then take it to the man, and he gave them a ta'weez to put in their pillowcase. Yes, is this magic? Yes, it is magic. Yes, it is magic. Anyone who asks you to wear something, like a shirt or a sleeve, or who asks you for one of your pieces of clothing, or anything of that nature, then straight away you know that this guy's involved in this is magic, because he's seeking assistance from the devils. Because the devils, when you take them the clothing that someone's been wearing, from the sweat, the devils can identify an individual. From the sweat of the, this is how they identify. This is how you can do magic. This is how people do magic, by taking the clothing of somebody. Right. So when people ask you, wear something and give it back to me, right? What they really want is they want the sweat from your body. Then they will implement a certain type of magic, as a result of will, or a result of which you will appear to be cured. But all it is just another form of magic that makes you think that you are cured. In reality, you are not. Watching magicians on TV and so on and so forth. Watching these people, is the scholars say that it is not permissible, because they are swindlers, liars, cheats, fraudsters, charlatans. And so a Muslim shouldn't be involved while seeking entertainment from these types of people. He's got better things to do. And so, we do not allow our children to watch them. We don't watch them. And ideally speaking, you shouldn't really have a TV in your house. Because by having a TV in your house, basically you're just saying to the shaitan, open field in my house, go and do what you want, do to my family whatever you want, open field. So you should not have a TV in your house anyway, inshallah ta'ala. So I advise you to get rid of the TV, and so you won't need to watch the magicians or anyone else for that matter on the TV, you know, which is just really the quickest and easiest route to corrupting yourself and your family and your morals and your manners and your deen. And so we advise you to get rid of that TV. Okay, I think really we are getting pushed for time. We'll finish off with, we've got some food. We have 15 minutes to finish, so we have to really stop right now. So inshallah, if you could assist. Before you stand up, anybody, just a quick announcement. We have the lesson every week here, Aqidatul Tahawiyya. We go through a book on creed, an explanation from the scholars. And so this is every Sunday at around 6 o'clock after Asr, 6:30. So that's like a regular lesson we have, inshallah ta'ala. And also, there are some books for sale now. If the sisters want to quickly come and look at some books right now, for about 5-10 minutes, they can come through the screen. It is blocked for them, inshallah, blocked off for them, inshallah ta'ala, just for 5 minutes. And then after that, there is some food. And if the brothers could please try to just assist in putting the chairs away and, you know, putting, because we have to be out of this place in literally 15 minutes. So with that, I'd like to thank everybody for attending. We hope that this has been of benefit. And subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant wa astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.